Hello and welcome to another episode of Peripheral Vision. Now, this episode is going to be a trilogy of questions that our young people have given. And this trilogy, the reason I put it together is that you could tell the story, I could answer each of these questions individually, but they can also be brought together in a kind of narrative, and also because it's easier then to kind of understand one question from the other one. And so, let's give it a shot. Today's first question just says this: who was your favorite pope and why? Now, this is a difficult question for me to answer because my conversion to the Catholic Church came directly as a result of the nature of the papacy itself. And so when I first started realizing that I was having some doubts about the Protestant Christian background in which I was raised, it was all of a sudden when the nature of the papacy hit me like a thunderclap that all of a sudden my world had to change. And that was the reading of the passage, "And you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and that which you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, will be loosed on earth will be loosed in heaven." And I remember reading that and going, oh no. I could no longer buy into the lie that Jesus had no intention of founding a church. Now, there's a whole bunch of nuances that go in there, and I don't want to say that Protestants or anybody who don't believe in the papacy are lying, but I reached the point myself where I couldn't deny the necessity of a church, the necessity for a role like the papacy, and my confession that Jesus is the Son of God. I reached a point where I either had to reject the nature of the church as apostolic with the Bishop of Rome or reject Jesus. I couldn't have one without the other. And so Peter then has an important role in my heart. And I'm not saying he's my favorite, I'm actually giving you four. And those aren't the only four, just enough I have time for. I picked Peter as the beginning because he is the counterpoint to all of the temptations and fears that we would have when we think of an institution that has an infallible head. Because Peter is quite open in saying how fallible he is, and yet he still speaks for the church. And so it is this understanding that there's a separation between the office of the man and the man himself. Even though Peter, the office is always Petrine throughout history, that they are always the successor of Peter and speak in his name, Peter, however, does not get the revelation of himself, but his eyewitness account. It's something that he saw. And so implicit in that is his own sinfulness. Implicit in that is his own foolishness. And that is one of the things that helped me understand the relationship of the church with Christ. That yes, she is his immaculate bride, but she is patterned by Mary. The leaders of the church, not so much. We have the struggle. And one of those things that keeps a priest or a bishop humble, and a pope especially, is a knowledge of their own sinfulness. And that is precisely what kept Peter grounded in the truth, is that he was given this authority not because he deserved it, but because the people of God need it. And they don't need a perfect pope. They need somebody who models holiness. And there's only one of us in history that was sinless. For the rest of us, we need a model, not who's perfect, but who struggles to figure out the truth and sometimes is in conflict with it. And so Peter is number one. Number two would be Leo the Great. Now, he lived in the 5th century and was a pope at a time when the papacy was not quite as prominent as we would think. Because even though the Bishop of Rome was understood to be the successor of St. Peter, the practical power of the pope was rather diminished. Because then for a lot of the early church, after the what's called Peace of Constantine, Christians were, all the churches were understood to be autocephalous, which means having their own head. And so even though the Bishop of Rome was the Bishop of Rome, all the other bishops weren't branch managers. They had their own autonomy. They had their own identity. But they still respected the Pope. And in a time when the natures of Christ were under controversy, it was the clarity of Leo the Great's teaching And yet the clarity amidst the paradox of Christ's person that demonstrated to the larger world that, in fact, Peter still continues to speak in the church, and he was speaking through Pope Leo, through what we would later call the Chalcedonian formula. There's a book called The Tome of Leo, which is incredibly small. Like, tome is usually what you think for a big book, but The Tome of Leo is just a few short pages. You can find it on Google, hint, hint. And it describes the two natures of Jesus, both human and divine. Not only that, he also successfully negotiated for Attila the Hun to not destroy Rome. Good for him. Third one, is Gregory the Great. And I feel personally indebted to Gregory the Great for two particular witnesses in his Christian life. One is because in that very class that revealed to me the nature of the papacy, it was Gregory, the history of Gregory the Great, that taught me how the papacy was viewed in the Middle Ages, even when they were not able to live up to that standard. And the standard would have been Gregory and beyond. Now, Gregory did a number of different things that we all today would recognize as kind and very, very good. One of them was when he sent Augustine of Canterbury to the Saxons in England and wanted Augustine of Canterbury, whom we'll celebrate in a few days, to preach the gospel to these pagan Saxons. Gregory just said something very simple to Augustine that always stuck with me. If you go among the Saxon peoples, the Angles, and you find among the Angles an altar that can be repurposed and brought to the greater glory of God, then do it. What he is basically saying is you don't need to destroy a people's past in order to bring them the gospel. You can build on the good work that the Spirit has already done in them and bring it to its fulfillment. And I was like, that's really interesting for a guy who lived in the 6th century. The other thing that I really liked about Gregory is that although Pope, he never wanted to be. One of his cool, he's wrote a number of different really great documents. One of them is The Life of St. Benedict, which is a very important book in my own spiritual formation. But was when he was describing that being a Pope is not as fun as one would think. Because real power, as we discovered already in St. Peter, always exists for the people that it serves, not for the person who's wielding it. So Gregory, in the spirit of Saint Benedict, realized that headship or authority should, in a sense, be a slight burden on the person who's exercising it. It should be their deepest vocation. But Gregory saw his deepest vocation to be a monk, a humble monk hidden in a monastery praying to God. But he was dragged out of the monastery in order to become a pope. He was like, I didn't want to be a pope. I wanted to pray. Now I've got to hang out with warlords and go to parties and do meetings. And all of these things are actually keeping me from my closeness to God. And I'm doing it for the sake of the world. And sometimes the world's not so happy about it. But then the funny thing is that Gregory is so greatly appreciated. When Western civilization had collapsed, he was one of the only people in the West, especially in Italy, who was working for the poor and the vulnerable. And he, still to this day, has written the manual on pastoring. This is like two books that are the best in the ancient church. One is on the priesthood. I think it was Basil the Great. My memory is failing me and I choose not to edit this out. And the other one is Gregory the Great when he writes on pastors. And so that was a tremendous model for me. The fourth great would be John Paul II, that I was, who was Pope when I was being converted as becoming a Catholic. Now, I wouldn't say actually that I like John Paul better than a lot of the other 21st century bishops of Rome. Like, I love John the 23rd, I love Benedict the 16th, and Francis, I won't say anything about Francis until his pontificate is done. Like, he's a great guy, but you always gotta wait until the story's over before you know the plot. And I just choose John Paul II because, as a paragon, this guy is it. Well-educated, athletic. Like, I'll try a well-educated. He's beat me on that one. He's very athletic. He's definitely got me beat on that. Like, in every possible dimension, John Paul II was, you know, basically a kind of Superman. And I admire that. But what I admire more not his Superman-like qualities, but having those qualities was very humble and kind. Tough when he needed to be. There's a whole bunch of interesting examples from his life. But not only was he a Superman in that kind of real sense, but he was a Superman with the poor, against the people, while for them at the same time, who had delusions of supermanliness. Both communism and fascism, and Nazism, but fascism in Italy, both communism and Nazism had this view of the self-made man apart from God. And what John Paul II does, and he's more of a symbol for me than as a man in this sense, like a superhero, he contradicted the delusions of power by identifying with the poor. And he wrote extensively, theologically, on this point. And so he tried to make the downtrodden, the lonely, the abandoned, the sick and the lost, the primary emphasis of the church. And that when we worship power, we ultimately fail. And sadly, that is something that is so hard to understand. And because, while being so capable, was able to do that, he remains, in that sense, a hero to me. But I would say I don't admire his thought as much as I admire Benedict. I prefer John the 23rd's style and humor to John Paul II, but those are all personal preferences and taste, mostly because John the 23rd is a slightly more corpulent and jolly figure, which is more my style. So then the second question then is, what are the steps to becoming ordained? What is then the path to which someone becomes a priest, like those men are? Because they are priests forever. When someone is ordained to the priesthood, it is like baptism and confirmation. It extends beyond death. So unlike a doctor, for instance, if somebody works to become a doctor and as a noble vocation, serves the poor, the needy, the sick, all that stuff. When that person dies, in heaven, they don't call them Dr. Bill. But in heaven, they will be recognized as saints and recognized as priests. Now, of course, however, John Paul II, John the 23rd, all those different guys were ordained not just priests, but bishops. So a bishop is actually the real priest. He's the high priest in a diocese. A priest like myself is a collaborator with the local bishop. So I get my priesthood from God through the bishop in my life here in the parish. And so the process to becoming ordained is the process of training an individual man to become what we believe God is calling him to be. So along that path towards being a priest of God. And so this actually starts in your childhood. You'd think that this is true, but it is. Because Jesus calls a whole man to the priesthood, not a part one, and he's not a role player. He doesn't just put on clothes and then pretend to be Jesus. He has to be like Christ, but in his own personal and unique way. So like St. Peter and like those other gentlemen that I've mentioned through history that lived out the priesthood, they did it as themselves. So first is to become a human being. We call this human formation. So it starts in your childhood, when you're 6 years old, 5 years old, when you learn how to take responsibility for your choices, when you learn how to do the good and to choose the good over evil. All those small choices have to accumulate through a lifetime. And so, yes, it requires that in your youth, you learn skills. I would say right now, the only regret from my childhood is that I never learned how to play a musical instrument. Now, I wouldn't play one as a priest, but it would certainly be helpful to be able to read music. But this is the cool thing about being a priest. Every every human skill can be brought into it. Every human skill can be brought into it. And so you don't need to plan too far ahead in youth, for instance, to prepare for it. What you need to do is to find a good skill that is within your reach that you can build on and train yourself in it. And then you might be surprised by what sort of miracle it can grow into something beautiful. Even something as ridiculous as video games can sometimes have a help. I'll tell you how it works. I've got fairly good hand-eye coordination for doing things during the Mass while not looking at it. All from video games. Now, I'm not saying play video games all the time. I'm saying that that small thing helped me in all these other areas. Further to that, learn to know and appreciate who you are as God's gift. So while developing your skills and talents and all of those different things, the next phase, an important phase it is to be authentic with who God created you to be. Learn to know what you actually enjoy doing. This might seem counterintuitive, but it teaches you a certain humility. It teaches you a certain wisdom to be able to say, you know what? I don't care what my friends think. My favorite band is the Bare Naked Ladies. This was me in high school, but it was going to come out wrong. It says, no matter what people say, I like Bare Naked Ladies. I was like, I think that needs context. You should start by saying the band. I like a band, and I don't care if it makes me look not cool. I'm going to dress a certain way. I don't care what people think. This is who I am for now. I'll give you an example. Not only did I like the Bare Naked Ladies when I was in high school, but when I was in high school, I wore suits to school. It's quite embarrassing. Because it kind of gave me a sense of maturity, responsibility, that I cared about my appearance. Now, clearly, it's not just COVID. I don't care about that as much anymore. Life kind of took that out of me for the most part. But at the time, at least, it was preparing me and training me for loving something for its own sake rather than for its social utility. So this is an important skill to develop in your youth in preparation for not just priesthood, but for everything. Everything. Because to be a good priest, you'd have to also have the qualities of a good father and a good employee and a good friend. So all of these integrated human mysteries are a part of priestly formation. But gradually what happens, and this at least happened to me, you can't live out who you really are in the world. Now, before I became Catholic, this was a painful experience because all of the things that everyone would tell me would make me happy, I looked at and went, no? Just no? And I won't go into too much of how disillusioning that was or the prompts for it, because for each person, they're different. But I just kind of looked at it and said, I can't do that and be me. And so while this was happening, I was in university and I was going to university because I wanted to. Actually, it started, I had nothing better to do. I was just working and bars were boring and all that stuff. So I was just like, you know what? I enjoy more the excitement of my philosophy class than all the other stuff. And I know that sounds ridiculous, but it was really exciting to me. And then it was there when I finally admitted that I'm going to do this philosophy stuff because it is helping me be a better man, that all of a sudden, what I was saying about the history of the church, all of a sudden, poof, called me out and said, you're not going to be a good politician. You're never going to be a good professor. You'd have never been all of those different things. But as a priest, you can be all of those things at the same time and prepare yourself for eternity. And then I said, dude, sign me up. That's exactly what I want. It is, in a sense, the meta skill. Priest, prophet, and king. But it's a different order. Not of power and coercion, but of suggestion and invitation, like Gregory, like Peter, like Leo. An invitation to freedom, like John Paul. So I was like, oh, okay, this is exactly what I need to be. So then, the moment that I realized that this is what I wanted, then I realized I had to become Catholic. Translation, live your Catholic faith where you live. Don't fantasize about where you think you ought to be. Where you ought to be is where you are. So you do everything you can to live the Catholic faith to its utmost in your locality. Participate in a ministry. Do it well. And don't always strive to be on the top, because every priest should know what it's like to work on the bottom. In everything. Everything from altar serving to food banks to everything. You need to know what it's like on the ground level. So you learn that. You work at your education. Start reading the faith, reading the scriptures. And this is, again, long before the seminary. The question of whether or not you should date, I would say this. If you are discerning the priesthood, then discern the priesthood. If you're dating, date. I find it very annoying when a guy is discerning the priesthood while stringing a young woman along. That's cruel to her, and it's cruel to himself. And it works both ways. Make a choice and stick with it, and accept the consequences. And if you decide to change your mind, then change your mind and stick with it. Now, gradually, what happens is that God reveals slowly whether or not this is for you. And you can tell because, having practiced authentic desires that lead to virtue, you'll start finding whether or not this is actually bringing you joy or making you miserable. Classic sign a guy should stop discerning is if he sees the formation and training like a drudgery. Yes, it's hard and has its challenges, but he should know in his bones that he's happier now that he's discerning than he was before. And then that compounds, it develops, and it builds. Then he eventually goes to a vocations director and to a bishop, and then is willing to submit his life to that bishop as a starting phase. Which, also, by the way, I am the vocations director for this diocese, at least temporarily, because, you know, who knows how long this will last. And, this is important, do what they say. Now, I'm not just saying this because I have this role and I can tell you what to do. Again, if you're a priest who can't follow instructions, save yourself a lifetime of misery. Learn how to follow good instructions, even instructions that aren't so good. Learn how to find the good. This is why you should do a ministry from the bottom and do it without fanfare. Maybe you're in a class and you're teaching, and there's a teacher that's above you, and then they have more responsibility, and you say to yourself, you know, I could do a better job than that person. No one cares, you can. Learn how to be humble in that moment. Because if you can't be humble under somebody when you're given power, you are not going to be fun to be around. So through seminary, the seminary, after the vocations director and bishop accepts you, then they send you to a seminary, and then you work with the seminary for the formation of your character and take it seriously. And this is the most important thing of all when you're in the seminary. As the genie said to Aladdin, tell the truth! For your own sake and for the church's. Don't do it to make mommy and daddy happy. Don't do it to please your grandparents. Do it because this is what God is calling you to do. Be willing to admit your weaknesses, being willing to admit your flaws, and to go from there. And then when you're ordained, you become Father so-and-so. This leads us then to the third question. Why do we call a priest Father? Because it's a sacrament. Now Jesus says to his disciples, call no one on earth your father. And he's right. Because you have one Father, and he is in heaven, and one teacher, the Son of Man. But we call priests Father, not because they've earned it, but because we need it. We need that presence of Christ in the midst of the church. That presence of Christ that forgives and heals and sanctifies. We need that power present in the church. But one of the interesting miracles is that God gives us that power exercised in the church, but as St. Paul describes, in earthen vessels, in weak things, namely priests. A priest confesses the sacraments, makes the Eucharist holy, forgives your sins, not because he is holy, but because the sacrament given to him is effective. And so he's exercising a power that the Pharisees rightly pointed out in the Gospels, only God can perform. Only God can forgive sins. Only God can turn bread and wine into the body and blood of Christ. But you'll notice that Jesus himself says that he now gives his ministry to his apostles. So any person that claims the apostolic ministry of the priesthood by their own right has forgotten the fundamental nature of the priesthood, which is a gift. But the fatherly role extends beyond just the sacramental, but it also extends to the realm of what we call in the church the charism of governance, the leading of a parish. Because only a priest and a bishop can govern the faithful. By that I mean run a parish. Now, a deacon, for instance, might be named an administrator for a time, or a layperson might be decreed as an administrator for a time, but only a priest can be a pastor, a shepherd. And that image of shepherd and father go together. Because a priest, this is how all of the New Testament images kind of come together. A priest is a priest, a shepherd, and a father. A priest and a prophet and a king. The people of God are the offering. The Eucharist is partly the means by which the priest governs the people. But it's not just in the Eucharistic celebration in the Mass that he acts in a priestly fashion. Yes, even when he's sitting through a boring finance meeting, and I'll tell you, sometimes they are pretty boring. And not only are they boring, but they make you feel kind of dumb. Like, after all these years of studying theology and blah, 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 and sometimes people say to me, it's like, hey, Father, you know, your homilies are long and I don't quite understand it. It's like, you know what? I know exactly how you feel. Because I was sit through a meeting led by competent lay people and they're talking about gicks and ars blabas and finance blahs of lugals. And I'm just going, explain that to me again. And it's worse when I have the last say in something I don't quite understand. But you get the point. A good father knows his limits. He might be the one ultimately responsible for every choice that is made. That's why the priest has a plenitude of power. He must be willing to take responsibility for everything that happens inside the parish. Even things he tried to stop from happening. So say, for instance, I can spend 5 years, I haven't been in Christ the King for 5 years yet, but say I spent 5 years trying to prevent two people from fighting, constantly encouraging them and building them up. And then they start fighting. And then I get blamed by being called out to the carpet. You know whose fault it is? Mine. Now, not in a codependent way, they still made their choices, but I'm responsible for it. And I'm not only responsible for all the different people that are in the parish, I'm responsible for all the people that are out there that are not a part of the parish, that are looking from the outside. I'm responsible for them too. And even when the children can say, I hate priests and I hate the church, does a father stop being responsible for his children even if they don't like him? In fact, every kid has had a moment when they don't like their parents. What makes it consoling for me is that I am playing the role of the father. I'm not smart enough or capable enough to actually be that. And so, indeed, through training and discipline, through a lifetime of choices and a desire to be the best that you can be, not better than others, but the best that you can be, then you'll just discover it. But you start by being a member of your parish. And again, please don't jump around from parish to parish to find one that suits you or to find a religious community that fits your ideals. That is not how the church works. Cause so you get ordained? Who says that you're going to go to the parish you wanted? Or who says that you're going to be, even in the religious community that you like, be working with brother so-and-so that you like? Every brother and priest will tell you that a searching after the rainbow's end only leads to destruction and blame and criticism. It doesn't do us any good. So a good father is what a priest is meant to be. And that's why I usually encourage all unmarried young men to start by discerning the priesthood. Because you can't discern marriage. It doesn't make any sense. You can't discern marriage because to discern marriage, you have to have a person to discern with. You know, like you don't discern marriage never having met your possible wife, because what you need to be able to start doing is to say, am I willing to lay down my life for her? Someone concrete. Usually people discern marriage. They just start fantasizing about what kind of person they want. Let's just say that doesn't end well. But if you discern the priesthood, then you will focus not on who you want to marry, but what kind of person you are. Which, by the way, succeeds in both worlds. We have a little joke in the seminary that young women are far more attracted to seminarians than the seminarian's own virtue deserves. We call them poachers, by the way. But the fact is that they're much more likely to appreciate a guy who's willing to try something difficult, to be a better man than he could be, and to do it for the sake of others. That's what it means to be a good father. So train to be a priest, or at least think about it. Be the best man that you can be. And if it becomes abundantly clear that God is not calling you to it, then great. Find something else out. In that sense, you can't lose. And for me, that is all the signs of the glory of God. And so in this trilogy, I had an experience of the call to adventure. And then the steps to becoming ordained is the becoming the hero. And then the third is realizing how that person lives out their hero's journey. And it's not a mythology. It's not science fiction. It's better than that. It's life. God bless you.